Hello everyone, thanks for attending this webinar with us today. We are just going to wait for 1 or 2 minutes until 3 p.m. and just before we jump in the meeting. Okay, then I think it's time to start. So, hello everyone. Thanks for attending this webinar with us today. Thanks a lot, Michael, for taking the time to share some interesting feedbacks and testimony on the project we conducted together earlier this year. Just before we jump in, for the attendance, you have a configuration panel on the left, on the right of your screen, where you are able to ask all your questions. So please do not hesitate to ask any questions you have, whether it's business or technical questions. And we'll make sure before the end of the meeting that we'll answer each one of them with Michael and Hanan. And also, I think you have a feature to switch between the different videos and the slides, so do not hesitate to use it. So before we jump in, we'll quickly introduce ourselves for those who don't know us. So I'm Mathieu. I've been working at Artifact for the past 3 years as a consulting director. And among other things, I'm co-leading the Artifact's offer about AI in contact centers with my colleague Hanan.
Hi everyone, my name is Hanan. I joined Artifact 5 years ago now. And as Mathieu said, co-leading this practice around AI for call centers, more on the data and the technical part.
And I'm Michael. I'm at HomeServe for 4 years now, and I'm innovation and products director, so in charge of innovation, focusing on AI. Then market studies too, and to finish membership products, meaning all the home assistance product lines.
Okay, thank you, Michael. So what we're gonna cover together today, we'll just go through a really short presentation of who is Artifact and who are HomeServe. And then we'll go, we'll share some feedback from the entire journey of the project we conducted with Michael. So from the business context and the project genesis to the key achievements that we've made for the MVP we developed together and the next step that are now considered on Michael's side. So Hanan, maybe you want to tell a little bit about Artifact.
Yes, let's have a quick presentation. So Artifact is today divided in two business units. The first one that Mathieu and I represent today is the data consulting and transformation, where we provide services to company in order to leverage the data and to meet specific business expectations. We are going to go more in details on this business unit on the next slide, but just to present also the second one, the digital and data marketing, where mostly you will find creative and specialized marketing people working more on marketing topics. So in order to go more in details on the data consulting and transformation, basically it's divided into several practices going from a strategy to implementation. The main idea is that we help our clients to define the right strategy, to define also the right use cases to launch, implement these use cases, work with the IT in order to design and also build the needed engineering capabilities, and at the end be sure that we meet the business expectations. So today the practice we are going to present to you is the data for operations, and here it's a really good example of how we can leverage data like voice of customer in order to optimize and to work more efficiently on call centers.
And what about HomeServe? So HomeServe is an international group specialized in home services. We are present in 6 countries. You have the flags here. And we exist for 26 years now. We have been funded by Richard Arpin. We're still the CEO of the company. And we just integrated the FTSE 100 2 or 3 days ago. So it's great for us. And in the world, we have 8 million customers, more than 1 billion of revenue, and all these 8 million customers about 15 million of assistance contract with us. And if we focus on France, so just to be more clear about the concept of what we mean by home services. So HomeServe mission is to make home repairs and improvements easy. And so our specialty is home, and we really focus on bringing peace of mind to our customers when they need to deal or manage something linked to their home. And especially when they have problems with their homes, meaning breakdowns. We have 3 different activities. The first one is the home assistance business, which is the main one. We are selling home assistance contracts in a lot of different fields: plumbing, electricity, gas, locksmiths, household appliances, and connected devices. The second business is about maintenance policies, and this is something in heating and air conditioning equipment linked. And the final one is on-demand services for customers who are not really customers of home assistance or maintenance policies. They can, however, access our great network of professionals when they have problems, breakdowns, or small repairs and improvements to do. So what does it mean in terms of figures in France? HomeServe France, it's more than 1.1 million of customers. We have a very good retention rate, 89%, and we are about 130 million revenue this year. And in terms of jobs that we are doing for our customers, it's 1 intervention every 3 minutes. So it's more than 170,000 interventions per year. And for this, we have a great network of more than 4,000 traders.
Okay, thank you, Michael. So let's go through the business context before we jump into what we did technically on this MVP. So the first thing, Michael, when we started to have our first meeting together to frame the project, is that you immediately told us that contact centers were a key activity for your business model, right?
Yeah, that's true. Because for us, the phone channel is the most important one for the moment. Of course, we have the digital, of course, we have the mailing, but the phone channel is really the first and the most important one. And it's true at every step of the value chain. It's true for the sales. We have people or prospects calling us after a direct marketing acquisition campaign. because the phone is a CTA in the mailings, we use the phone to cross-sell our products too. And we have also transfers from our partners. So as some of our products needs some explanation, the phone is really interesting for that, to explain and sell the products. Then when people are customers, we've got customer service. And to handle any question or request, we've got this. And then at when people are customers and there is this moment of people have an home assistance contract and they have a breakdown, it's what we call the moment of truth, because it's really if the intervention really shows the value of the home assistance contract. So people call us, and then our job is to reassure them, diagnose the problem, and deploy a trader. So for all these three activities, we have in-house call centers in Lyon, in France.
Okay, really interesting. And also what we understood is that before we started working together, that you have already been experiencing AI for a while at HomeServe.
Yeah. A long time ago, I would say, 3 or 4 years before now, our first contact with AI was about thinking about new channels. How AI is inventing or reinventing or revolutionizing new channels of communication with customers. And we explored these new channels that were at the time enabled by AI and mostly conversational AI. So we started in 2017 with a chatbot. It was really at the time chatbot was everywhere. So we worked on a chatbot. It was much more an RD project to test if the AI was ready to understand and the NLP natural language understanding was ready to understand the diagnosis. So we launched Tom, and we won the Argus d'Or de l'assurance digitale this year. And you can see the picture here. Tom was at the time a star with Lara de Mythic, which was the other one. But then after this test, we really have this pivot on the voice, because in our job, the voice is really the communication channel that people ask to use to speak about breakdowns in their homes. We are doing a lot of studies on that, and 9 out of 10 out of 10 French prefer to use the voice and to explain at the phone, for example, or through a conventional AI new channels the problem, and not through chatbots on Messenger. So we did this pivot, and we now work on virtual assistants. Last year we launched two virtual assistants on Google Assistant and Amazon Alexa, when you can be helped by the assistants if you got a problem, whether you're a customer or not. And this year we are not exploring a content strategy. So we put tutorials online and through Google Assistant, and now we are in collaboration with Amazon to launch this this month. And HomeServe will answer questions directly asked to Alexa. So we are working with Amazon to be in zero position equivalent.
Okay, great. So all this is about creating new user experiences, integrating new channels to interact with your customers. And if we focus on your contact center activity as it is right now, what are you expecting from artificial intelligence in this field?
Yeah, you're right. So we alongside this exploration of new channels which are enabled by AI, we ask a new question, or it's a complementary question, I would say, is how AI can help us to improve our efficiency and customer experience in our existing channels. And as I said, the phone is the first and most important channel at HomeServe. So it's a very important question to say how AI can improve our experience at the phone. And we had this reflection together too about AI, and we thought it was very interesting to explore the first true level, meaning the speech analytics, because a lot of customers are calling us, but even if our agents are very good at their jobs, they cannot handle all the informations that are given by the customers. So we've got all this data, which are calls that we are not really exploiting for the moment, in terms of understanding, in terms of CRM enrichment, etc. So for us, it's really the first step to have AI help us to understand better. And then, perhaps you want me to comment on the rest, because it's really the first part, the speech analytics, and then we will have other cases on coach AI agent, perhaps, or even to automate some low value. So the thing on the right, automated support. So of course, every company has calls that are very low value calls. And the question is, how can I automate these calls to have my agents, very qualified agents, handling better higher value calls? And the key benefits expected are a better customer satisfaction and a better efficiency, of course. So with this, we at HomeServe, at Innovation, and then with other people in the company, we built, I will say, a task force to work on speech analytics. And we met different companies, very good solutions, and we met you guys. In the task force, there were business people, operations, IT, data, innovation. And we decided collectively to build an asset for the company. We're in relation with speech analytics. It's not because we like handling very complex IT things at HomeServe. It's not our job, but it's really because we are convinced that to be very effective, the speech analytics need to be really tailored to the company, the products, its customers, its processes, and if we are not building an asset by as it's written on the slide, adapting the architecture, adapting the algorithms, we are losing a lot of value. So we made a clear choice to make it, and combining the technology and the skills objective. So the objectives on the technology side is to complete our new internal data platform with all these parts dedicated to voice data. We are just building this data platform, so we are ready to handle this sort of tasks, IT tasks, much easily than before. So it's an enabler. Then, as we are looking to speech analytics and all we can do with speech analytics, it's a lot of different use cases. We said to us, okay, we really need to do to make the most agnostic platform we can do, because we need to have the architecture enabled to treat multiple subjects and use cases. And then we need to adapt the algorithms directly to what we are really doing, and to have this question of going to the business and coming back to data science that Anand will talk about afterwards. And the second objective was about people. So we all know that the biggest companies are data driven. We all know that it's the future, and the future is really now. So we wanted through this make strategy to develop internal expertise on NLU, of course, on data science algorithms, and on all this architecture of using the good APIs and dealing with it.
Okay, thank you, Michael, for all these details. Now let's go through what we built concretely for the project we started conducting together.
Yes, so on that, Michael, first question is, on your perspective, what was the objective of this project?
The objective was really to be sure that speech analytics was mature enough to create value for the business, because we are businessmen, so our interest is not about testing technologies for the beauty of technologies. Our interest is to test, to have this first step of testing technology and see, is it mature enough? What are in this I would say this maturity, what can we do with it? What are the relevant use cases that we can choose with the business in terms of value, business value and feasibility? And just through several weeks of work, we are confident that we can have a good answer on how can speech analytics help us improve our customer experience and efficiency. And so this was the objective, to test and see the business value of the technology. And we adopted for this a philosophy of work. We really wanted to optimize time to market, meaning we are not really to build the entire architecture at the beginning, but we are building long-term things. So the algorithms that we are building now, when we will industrialize the solution, we will use them. It's not a problem. It's not it's a long-term project, but it's small long-term in a big long-term vision. And so we build core tech components, yes, needed for the future use case.
So could you tell us a bit more about which use case we ended developing with the business teams?
Yes. So we had this task force with innovation, operations, IT, data at HomeServe, and you joined us guys, and we said, okay, let's ask the business, what do they think about speech analytics, and what do we think, how could speech analytics could handle some of their challenges, in fact. So we did a workshop, internal workshop, and we selected two use cases. It's about how can we select use cases? I think it's a good question. The first one is about the challenge. So what is the biggest challenge at the time for people internally? And the second criterion is about feasibility. What can we do in only several weeks of an MVP? So we did this exercise and we finished with two use cases. The first one is about the customer service call center. Because a lot of people are calling us every year. And we know why they are calling us, but we ask ourselves, is it possible to be more precise? Is it possible to have a data-driven situation at the time? So we did this work on the calls of this call center and working on the topics and subtopics of customer calls. And it was interesting to work on the detection of irritants. So if you link topics with customer satisfactions, you've got irritants. we had this this reflection, and I think we will go deeper just afterwards about the potential of cross-sell calls, and then if you do, you have your irritants, you've got your potential, you can split low value from high value calls, then you can do some operational optimization. The second use case is about compliance. So we are selling insurance contracts. So we've got regulation, of course, and at HomeServe, we really want to be very respectful of the regulation. It's in our DNA because of our history. So we've got a lot of people in at HomeServe and at our partners call centers too that are looking to this compliance things and criteria on the sales calls, and we ask the question: is speech analytics able to help us on work on compliance controls? Could we go from a random calls selections to a suspicion risk of non-conformity, meaning that people will only concentrate on their force on suspicion cases and not losing time on perfect calls?
Okay, and what's interesting to recall when we selected also these two use cases. So apart from the business side, the interest to combine these two use cases is that they needed to develop different models, different algorithms to enable each one of these use cases. So moving forward on both these use cases at the same time allowed us to build several microservices that could be reused in the future as well.
Yes, and that's totally true, Mathieu. And I think it's testing different aspects of speech analytics, in fact. Mm-hmm. The first one is, I would say, quite a common use case. The topics, subtopics, of calls, irritants, it's the basis of your solution. Then the second one, is different. It's calling on, and we will see that afterwards, but it's calling on different expertise and calibration of the technology. So by choosing two different use cases, we are able to do what our objective was, to test the technology.
Yeah, to see where are the exact limits of speech analytics right now.
Exactly.
Yes, and as we said during all of this this discussion, I think what also was a really key success for this project is the fact that we worked closely with a different team from HomeServe and also from Artifact. So we were organized in a way that business people within Artifact are talking with business people from HomeServe. The same for the data team, and also the same for the software engineers and IT team. And this organization, with all the sponsors and all the working people together, exchanges in the daily basis on each daily stand-up and working together, help us to go in the right direction really quickly and to converge to these two use cases and the two solutions that we've made during this project. And I think that the organization, and especially within this specific time with COVID-19, was really helpful to be sure that we can deliver at the end what we expected. So maybe you want to add a word, Michael, on that?
Yes, so I'm managing and making innovation project for years now. And I would say, in my mind, there are two ways of dealing with innovation project. The first one is the shelter. So you really want to protect your project like a diamond, and you don't want other people from the business to come and say anything. And it's not what we chose for this project. What I chose for this project was the contrary. It was very at the very beginning, having different people at HomeServe engaged in a task force. And so people from data, as I said, operations, customer success, IT, etc. And we met different solution providers and we chose together the solution. And then we had these people really involved in the project because it was their project. So it's for me, this long-term involvement of people in the business is a key success factor.
Yeah, and especially in this project, we had only 4 weeks of work. We were all working from home, so it was the first collaboration between us. So it was particularly challenging to be efficient in this context. And I think the application of basic agile methodologies really allowed us to create the most value that we could during these 4 weeks, being able to iterate with all the different teams each morning before the developers were moving on with their with the jobs. It was really key in the success of this project. Yeah.
So we've talked a lot about microservices within this presentation, and I think it deserves at least a slide to introduce the topic. Recalling the fact that at the beginning, what we're collecting is calls from customers, so what we call voice of customers, and the first step is recording. So we recorded all this voice. What was also really interesting to emphasize is the fact that we got two specific audio files, one from the customers and one from the agent. So it was a really high quality data that we got at the beginning of this project. Then we did a specific task of speech to text. The idea is to translate the voice into text. On this project, we used Google speech to text API in order to go from voice data to text data. And what we've called microservices is the idea of not building code in order to meet a specific use case, but more to say, okay, code should be thought as Lego bricks when you can have a lot of use cases that will rely on all these Lego bricks. For example, the use case number one will rely on Lego A and B. The use case number two will rely on the Lego A and C. And the idea is to build these Lego bricks in order to be reusable within all the use cases. And also that if tomorrow we are going to launch another use case that is completely different from a call center activation, for example, but is more related for marketing, but at the end it will need a specific topic modeling analysis, we can rely with really few work on what has been done within this project. So on the microservices we build on this project, there's the topic modeling part that I'm going to present in detail just after. The idea is to extract topics and motivation from the customers, then entities extraction to extract specific words, specific verbatim, etc. Then also sentiment analysis, when we analyze what the customer is saying and try to measure if he's satisfied or not. And what is really important is at the end of this project, whatever this project is a success in terms of business results or no, and at the end it's a good success, I think, but even if it wasn't a success, the idea is at the end we got some Lego bricks that can be reusable for another use case and we capitalize on the work that has been done. So it's really, really important. And this way of working, in my opinion, is key to be sure that we leverage the most the work that has been done. So maybe going into some examples of microservices. So the slides are in French. The example are in French because we work on the French data, but for English speaker, I can translate a bit. But the idea is on your left, you have a conversation between a customer and the agent, and the customer is calling for relocation because he's moving, and we analyze this call and detecting some verbatim and also some vocabulary that help us to flag this call as a call from a customer who is moving. It's not a rule-based topic modeling, I precise. It's more something when we detect some lexical language that is related to the fact that the customer is moving. And at the end, what you see underlying in green is the fact that the customer at the end was really happy of the call. He's saying, okay, really clear for me. Thank you very much for all these details. So the customer is happy, and we flagged this call as a customer who is happy. On your left, what is really interesting is that there's a lot of things to say on this left example. First, but like the right example, sorry. So on this right example, first we see that the customer is calling because they have a request for information about payment. We also see that at the beginning of the call, the customer was not really happy. He's saying, okay, I don't understand, etc. So he's not a happy customer, but at the end of the call, he's happy. So what we have success to do is not only to measure the satisfaction, the average satisfaction of the call, but also to have an evolution of the satisfaction within the call. That is really an interesting feature to see, even if the call is a bad call at the beginning, did we success in transform this call into a call where the customer is happy at the end? And that's the goal of the call. And also what is interesting is that in blue, underlying in blue, you can see that the agent is trying to make an attempt to do some cross-sell. So I think that even if the customer is not happy at the beginning, the fact that the agent try and dare to make a cross-sell is meaning that the customer is happy and is a good position also to be to hear some cross-sell. So what is really interesting is that you see that it's the same input data, but on the same input data, we manage to do many analysis, topic extraction, sentiment analysis within the call, and also extraction of, for example, cross-sell attempts. So that is basically a good illustration of the way microservices are working. And to complete on this topic modeling part, usually what we do is do a bottom-up analysis, taking all the data with no input and trying to say, okay, I have all this data. Can I understand what are the topics within this data? What are the interests of the customers? And we do some what we call unsupervised approach, where we don't have any prior on the data. We have some prior, but not specific prior on the data that will help us to have a good classification. But we propose to the business first classification, and the business will help us to say, okay, you see this topic, you can split into two specific topics because it's really different, or maybe the topic number A and topic number B, you can merge together because at the end of the day, it's the same issue. And then working with the business, we can redesign the way our unsupervised approach flagged the calls. And then with this new classification, we can train a supervised algorithm in order to infer and to roll out and to spread all the knowledge that was given by the business. And with this iterative loop between data analysis, business validation, business insight, data analysis, we at the end of the day succeed in having a right and good classification of the call. And that's underlined the fact that working with the business and working with the different business units of the company is a key success, because without this input, it would be really complicated for us, for example, to understand why, given a specific month, we have this topic that is increasing. All these questions are answered by the business, and it makes us more reliable on the analysis and the topic modeling that we have built.
Okay, thank you. Just a quick reminder, do not hesitate to ask us any question on this part, whether they are business or technical. We will save some time at the end of the presentation to answer them. So here we detail what we've done basically on the data and technological side to answer the question that were raised by HomeServe on these two use cases. Now we're going to focus on the kind of outputs we concretely generated thanks to this data work, and what can it be, how can it be used in the future by HomeServe. So Michael, if we focus on first on the use case one, which was about better understanding the calls handled by the customer service team, what are the main outputs and that were generated, and how do you plan on using them in the near future?
For me, the main result is the answer to the main question. In fact, I think the main result is that the technology is mature, it's speech analytics is ready to create value for the business. This is the main result for me. Of course, it's not magic. It needs human work, data scientist work, business work, as you said, Anan, but it works. It works. Of course, we are going to improve it, and we are only at the beginning, I think, of the journey. But for the business, it's ready to be used. To detail the main actionable insights that we add. The first one is about the topic classification. So why our customers are calling us. And we did this work, as you explained, Anan, and we sort out and we compared the topics, the data-driven one given by the speech analytics to the human classification that we add. And it was not really different, but now we are sure we have an objective and data-driven classification. But for me, this topic classification is just the beginning of the story. It's interesting when you apply over axes of analysis, like sentiment analysis. What you've done is the classification of the level of sentiment of the customers. And we could have done the same for agents, of course, and it could be interesting to do that too. We've done that, and what we discovered is that the dissatisfaction, so low satisfaction levels, were very rare. So it's good news for us, but we already knew that. And the satisfaction levels are not extremely high because people are not really excited about insurance. But for me, it's not no news on that too. And what's interesting here is that it's an axis of analysis too, sentiment. And when you cross data, then with CRM and with other things, we can go much, much deeper and produce more value. The thing we spent a little time, and we will need to go deeper on this with more and more data to be analyzed, is the potential of calls. And when I speak about potential, I speak about the cross-sell potential. So our customers are calling us, and as I described the products that we are selling a lot of different covers. We are asking our customers if they want to be covered on different things. We try to cross-sell. And we made this very interesting analysis, and I think it's the slide that the people in the business prefer of all the slides produced by us and this MVP. Is this cross-sell potential, and we will go deeper on this later in the presentation, I think.
Yeah, totally. Thank you, Michael. So just to help you visualize the kind of insights that were produced for this MVP, here you have the data visualization tool that was developed in-house on the HomeServe environment to help business people visualize the different types of customers' contact causes and their evolution in time. So Of course, most of the a lot of data are blurred since they are pretty confidential. But here you have an example of the topic classification that we've done with our solution. So you are able to have two levels of topics. So topics such as contract cancellation, contract information, and the subtopics that are related to them. So that allows business team to have a real deep objective understanding of the different customer contact root causes and their evolution in a defined period of time. Then, as Michael explained, this was cross-analyzed with customer satisfaction. So here, business teams are able to see what are the levels of customer satisfaction for each one of these topics and subtopics. So that allows basically operational teams to identify which type of calls are clearly well handled right now by the agents, and on the opposite, what are the calls that we have trouble to handle correctly and for which we may change our scripts or processes and so on. And an interesting feature.
Mathieu? Yes, may I add something? So here, the sentiment analysis is crossed with topics. But you can cross this with a lot of different axes. For example, you can cross with agents. So you can make an analysis. We didn't at the time to do that, but in a training perspective, you can do this data crossing of sentiment of the customers and analyze all the same all the calls from one agent and the other one, etc., and to see differences and to focus the training on for example on topics that some agents are not really managing well for the moment. So for us, it's really a gold mine that we really need to exploit in during the time with different analysis. And it's not just about having a tool of visualization, it's about what analysis can we do to answer our main objectives. And we can do a lot, really a lot.
Yeah, totally. And finally, regarding the cross-tab potential analysis that you mentioned earlier, so here we of course we hide the concern topics, but here you have a graph on which each bar represents a topic or subtopic, and we were able to analyze for each topic how often did the agents attempted to cross-sell a product, and how often did they succeed. And that allowed us to identify potential topics that seem at least to be over-exploited for cross-sell opportunities, such as the first one here, where there's a lot of attempts taken, but with a really poor conversion rate. And on the other side, we have topics for which the agent does not often try to perform a cross-sell attempt, but who have a really high conversion rate. So basically, this analysis was only done on a subset of data, but if we apply this on all the historical unserved data, that will allow business teams to identify which are the most high value types of calls and which calls should the agents focus on cross-selling.
Yeah, because we've got 23 different subtopics. So it means that if we want to have objective results in a statistical way, we need a lot of data to deploy on 23 different subtopics. But we cross the data with topics. What about crossing the data with topics and agent, or just agent? That's something we have in mind to focus the training on agents that either are not trying or attempting to offer cross-sell products to the customers, or that agents that are offering products that are not selling, So it's a question of percentage of proposition or percentage of conversion. But at every step, it's very interesting to have this tool and to exploit the data.
Yes, and if we look at quickly at use case two, because I think we just have 10 minutes left, including the answering the questions that we were asked in the chat. So, Mikael, could you tell us a bit more about the use case number two, what we've achieved regarding the risk of non-compliance detection in the sales calls?
Yeah, very quickly. So the question was, can we use speech analytics to detect suspicion of non-conformity in our calls? So here we work with you guys on the criteria we use in our conformity rating tool, and we try to look at what is making these criteria non-respected, and then the machine we'll go over and say and flag the call if we have a suspicion. On this, I think the approach is really interesting. We have a lot of things to do, and we had very good results on some criteria, and much more difficult results on other. And here it showed this use case was very interesting on the main objective of the MVP, about the maturity of the technology and the feasibility. It means that the speech-to-text performance still needs to be improved to manage this use case.
Yes, because for some of the criteria here, such as price, for example, you have to have a perfect transcript to make sure that you will be able to identify clearly that the agent mentioned the right product price. So if the STT performance is not perfect, you can miss some important information that the agent has said and that you can't find in the transcript. So right now the conclusion was, as it is right now, STT and NLP can be leveraged to better orient the work of your human controllers regarding compliance, but it's still not totally not mature enough to consider implementing automated processes for this compliance control. So Hanan, maybe you can quickly share recap the main learnings of this project.
And yes, I will do in 1 minute. So mainly the main learnings are three. First one is about the speech tech performance. Because it's the first step within the data pipeline, it's really important to do it in a good way. So we see that there's an improvement day after day on the different APIs. And I think that today the level of satisfaction is sufficient to do some analysis as we did, but there's still a lot of improvement that are possible to do it better. Also, as we said many times within this presentation, it's really important to include a business expert within this project in order to be sure that we build something that will be used at the end of the day first, but also that meet the expectations and the needs of the business. And then last but not least, it's important to start small, so in a specific perimeter on specific topics, and then to scale fast. And to do that, it's important to design the solution in a smart way, like microservices, working closely with the business, etc., in order to be sure that the day we need to scale, the scaling is not painful, and we can do it in a smart way.
And finally, Mikael, if you want to add to tell us a bit more about the next steps you consider on our side.
Yes, so we've done this MVP on two use cases, and now we, as I said, the technology is mature to handle some use cases. For the use cases which we think the technology is mature, we are formalizing with the operational teams a global business case. To leverage this MVP results and to work on, okay, what kind of value can we create and what are the costs of industrialization? And in a business way, does it make sense to industrialize? Yes or no? And this is a good exercise to do internally, because if you do that and the result is positive, there is no question of subjectivity to discuss. So we try to do this kind of business case exercise at each time at HomeServe. And for the other use case where we think the technology is not mature enough, or we are not using the good one, perhaps we need to optimize the speech to text performance and to work. And we are working in parallel in on these two threads. And then we will perhaps at some time move to real time use cases afterwards. But we really need to work on these business cases before to industrialize and then to have the architecture ready to go.
Okay, thank you, Michael. I think we have a few really interesting questions. The first one is about the different services that we're integrating within our data pipelines. Maybe Hanan, you can take this one. Which services are based on open source algorithms versus GAFA based technologies?
So the different services, the only service that is based on GAFA technology is the speech to text API. All the other microservices are open source microservices that are coding in Python for people who know the language. And the idea is to be really independent on this part, to make sure that at the end, HomeServe is able to first reuse everything and be sure that is integrated within their ecosystem and not dependent to any provider. So basically, it's also, I think, Michael, correct me if I'm wrong, but it's also one of the purposes of this project is to be sure that at the end, you are independent on this kind of initiative of analyzing voice of customers. So the only GAFA or whatever not open source API is the speech to text, and because today the cost to design a specific speech to text solution for a specific user, it's really huge. It takes a lot of time and a lot of money, of course, and at the end I think it's more reliable to use something that is existing already.
Yes, and since we're talking about money, there's a question about the cost of running this kind of analysis, either during the call in a live context or after the call. I think if we look at this kind of data pipeline, the most expensive parts in terms of data processing is clearly the speech to text. And the cost depends on mostly on two things. The first one is the volume of calls you handle, and the second one, which is quite important, is the average duration of the call. If I look at the different projects with HomeServe and with other partners that we worked on, the call duration goes from 6 minutes to 40 minutes from some sales call. So the cost really depends from context to another. And with Hanan, we're working on some solutions to optimize the cost of speech to text. For example, when you have a long discussion between a client and an agent with some blends within the discussion, we are working on some ways to cut this file, to reduce the size of this file in order to optimize the cost of the speech to text part of the pipeline. And Jonas, who asked this question, if you want us to provide you with some benchmark of the different cost of the different STT solutions, reach me via email and then we share some feedbacks to you. There's also a question about the correction of the topic modeling. Hanan, I don't know if you maybe you want to take this one. So basically the question is what happens if a call is attributed to the wrong topic? Is there a way to flag it, and how do we correct it, avoiding any wrong learning by the algorithm?
So today, what we can do is to train a specific algorithm in order to classify the call and to measure the performance of the algorithm, and to say, for example, on the classification, it will have a precision and a recall of each level. So in order at the end to be sure that we correct an algorithm that classify in the wrong way a call, the only way is to do it manually first, but it's not the optimal. And the second way is maybe to have some specific rule-based analysis on a specific vocabulary and say, okay, a call that have not one of these words won't be able to be classified at this topic. So we can build on top of the algorithm some intelligent and smart vocabulary extraction in order to be sure that we correct the call. Also, I think that is a bit complicated in that kind of use cases is that we are really dependent to the speech-to-text step. So if the speech-to-text, for example, did a wrong transcription, it would be complicated for the algorithm to classify in the right way the call. So there's also a lot of limitation, and the fact that the algorithm classified a call in the wrong way can also come from other reasons that are not related to the algorithm. So that's why it's a bit complicated to have a really strong way to correct when we have an error.
I think there's another rather business question. I think it would be interesting to have Michael's input on this. It's about how the project is received by the teams on the field. How well is the project received? Do you feel that any worries about the agents that may feel that this solution would in the future try to replace them or so?
No, yeah, it's a very good question. And this is not an automation project. So we don't really have a problem on this, because it's much more how can we know better what is going on the field. And for example, agents will be very happy if we are not asking them anymore to do the post-call classification, because it's not bringing them value. They lose several seconds doing it. So if the machine is doing it, they will be happy. And then, for example, we are basing our training on a few calls that or the team manager is listening of them, because the team manager has several agents, so he cannot listen to all the calls. So the team manager having this tool could be able to have much more objective analysis of the performance and the calls of the agent. So I think it's a good tool of bringing some objective data and trying to take all this, you know, administrative task of classification that agents don't like.
Okay, thank you, Michael. Another question about the performance of Google speech to text solution. What is the word error rate that we had for the STT solution? Question from Simon. I'm not sure. I don't think I have the figures right now. But still, an interesting thing to consider is that for every project that we handle using STT solutions, we actually use two different word error rate KPIs. The first one is a generic word error rate. So it just measures how many words from the voice were corrected, just transcribed into text. And the second one is a word error rate focusing on only the lexical fields that are specific to the business context. For example, if you work on the HomeServe context, we're going to evaluate the water rate specific to HomeServe vocabulary. So, for example, plumbing, for example, the name of the contracts, and so on. So, we always take into consideration these two different KPIs. I don't have the figures right now, but we can share the average performance that we can reach for generic and specific KPIs for this kind of project with you later on. No problem for us. And there's the last question regarding the architecture. So I think this could be this may be for Anan. How easy it is to move from this kind of architecture, which is based on the cold batch processing, to real-time architecture to handle real-time use cases?
So that's when microservices are the good answer. I think the fact that we design the code in order to be microservice make the go to live more easy. So what is needed first is to industrialize the data collection of the call and to be sure that we can build API to collect the data in real time and call the different microservices in real time too. So I think that the data science part is almost ready for a go to live. We just need to be sure that it's a package within the different APIs and that we build all the CI/CD pipeline in order to be sure that everything is going well. But the main work, is, in my opinion, is on the data collection and data exposition before and after the algorithm, where there's still a bit of work to do in order to go live. But it's not something that is tricky. It's just something that should be done in a good way to be sure that it's working.
And if you're interested, we can share with you also functional examples of functional architecture to manage this kind of use cases in a live and real-time context.
Now, I think the question is also for which use do you want to go live? Because you can do a lot of analysis on cold data. Then if you want to coach the agent, yes, you need to go live. If you want to automate, yes, you need to go live. But at the very beginning, working on cold data to fine-tune the algorithms, I think it's the good solution.
Yes, totally. Okay, so I think that's it for the questions. Let me just check if I missed one. No, I think we're done.
Yeah, done.
Okay, so thank you everyone for attending this webinar. Once again, thank you so much, Mikhail, for taking the time to share this insight with us today. We really appreciate it.
Thanks to everyone. It was very interesting.
This webinar was recorded, so each participant will receive the replay session by Monday, as well as the full presentation with all the slides. You have our contact details within the presentation, so if you have any additional question, don't hesitate to reach us. We'll give you an answer really, really shortly. Okay, so thank you everyone. Enjoy the rest of your day. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.